Good morning to all of you. Let us begin the session now. That is session number one of module number 4 it is. In this particular module, we'll talk about the classes and object and the classes and methods and the classes and functions, and as well as the most important part of this chapter is we'll talk about the main features of the object-oriented programming language, like the polymorphism, method overloading, operator overloading, as well as inheritance. Okay, so this is the overview of unit number 4 or module number 4. So we'll start with the classes and the object, then we'll move on to classes and functions, and the next one we'll talk about classes and methods it is. So let us begin the first topic of this session, that is the classes and object. So here is one class here that is called as the house, and there are four objects here. Okay, so that is one, the object 1, object 2, object 3 and object 4. And so let us see the relationship between these one. So that is all of them, that is all the four of them belongs to what class called as the house. They belongs to the same class called as the house object here, sorry, house class here. Okay, so that is how that is, in other words, so they also belongs to, or they makes use of a class called as the house. They makes use of the house or like class called as the house. That is, these are four are the objects, the object 1, object 2, object 3 and object 4. And all of them makes use of the class called as the house, right? And they are just making use of the data. Data in this case, it may be a TV or whatever the equipments you have, which is placed under the class, it will be made use by the objects here. Let us try to understand what you mean by object-oriented programming. Python is an object-oriented programming language, which means that it provides features that support object-oriented programming. So we call the Python programming as an object-oriented programming language because it features, or it provides all the features supported by an object-oriented programming language. Object-oriented programming has its roots in the 1960s, but it wasn't until the mid-1980s that it became the main programming paradigm used in the creation of new softwares. It is in the, during the 1980s it has become into existence, but until mid 80s, so it doesn't come into it was not considered as a main paradigm. It was developed as a way to handle rapidly increasing size and complexity of systems, and to make it easier to modify these large and complex systems over time. So these are basically developed to create or to develop rapidly increasing size and complexity of the software systems. The object-oriented system programming has been used in creating or developing rapidly increasing size and the complexity of the software system, and to make it easier to modify these large and complex system over a period of time. Up to now, we have been writing programs using a procedural programming paradigm. So until now, we are using, or we are making use of procedural programming language to write the program. In procedural programming, the focus is on writing functions or the procedures which operates on the data. So in the case of the procedural programming, we are basically concentrating on data, that is the manipulation of the data, or manipulation of the data or creation of the data by the functions or the procedures. But in the object-oriented programming, the focus is on the creation of objects which contain both the data and the functionality together. Okay, so in case of the procedural, we are concentrating on the data which is created by either the procedures or the functions. But in case of the object-oriented programming, we are working on the objects which basically contains data as well as functionality within it. Okay, So that is the major difference between a procedural programming as well as the object-oriented program. And user-defined component types. A class is in essence defines a new data type. It's basically a new data type defined by the user. Let us create our own user-defined type called as the point. Point is the class now, so okay, which is defined or which is created by the user. Consider the concept of mathematical point. Alright. So in two dimensions, a point of point is two numbers, and that are treated collectively as a single object. Okay. So that will it basically contains two numbers or the two coordinates, which is collectively considered as a single object. Okay. We have x and y coordinates, but this x and y coordinate belongs to a single object called as the point. In mathematical notation, points are often written in parentheses with a comma separating the coordinates. Okay, so in mathematical notations, we are writing these things within a comma separating the coordinates. For example, 0 and 0 represent the origin, and x and y represent the point x units to the right and y units up from the origin. Okay, we are using these coordinates within the parenthesis, stating that they represent the point, right? They represent the point. For example, 0 and 0 indicates they belongs to or they are from the origin, and x and y represent the point x units to the right and point y units up from the origin. And a natural way to represent a point in Python is with two numeric values. So we are just using two numeric values to represent a point. The question then is how to group these two values into a compound object. How to group them to make it as a compound object. The quick and the dirty solution is to use a list or a tuple, and for some applications that might be the best choice. That is, we are representing a single point using two coordinates, but the question is how to put them or how to put them together into a compound so that they are going to represent a single object. The best way is that you have to put them into a list and work on that. An alternative is to define a new user defined compound type called as a class. And this approach involves a bit more effort, but it has advantages that will be operant soon, right? We can have an alternative is that you have to create a class, and using that class you have to you have to build the applications. This approach involves a bit more effort, but it has advantages that will operant soon it is. And let us begin try to understand what you mean by a class. A class is the blueprint from which individual objects are being created, right? A class is nothing but a blueprint from which you are just going to create an individual objects. In object-oriented programming, a class is an extensible program code template for creating the objects, providing initial values for member variables and implementations of methods. So, okay, a class is nothing but a blueprint from which individual objects are being created. In object-oriented programming, a class is an extensible program code template for creating the objects, providing initial values for member variables and implementation of the methods. And let us look at a class is going to be defined. So we have something called as a class and followed by a point, right? So class is a name, or it is a keyword which is being used. And the name of the class is point here. The name of the class is point, and pass is nothing but we don't have any executable code here, or we don't have any code for this particular class. Class definition can appear anywhere in a program. So it can appear anywhere in the program, but they are usually near the beginning. Okay, after the input statements. Usually you can define a class anywhere in the program, but the best practice they are following is that they are putting the class definition at the beginning of your code or immediately after the input statements. The syntax rule for a class definition are the same as for other compound statements. So the syntax rules for a class definition are same as for the other compound statements. There is a header which begins with the keyword called as the class, followed by the name of the class and ending with a colon. There is a header which always begins with the keyword called as the class and followed by the name of the class and ending with a colon. This definition creates a new class called as the point. So it's going to create a new class called as the point. The pass statement has no effect. It is only necessary because a compound statement must have something in its body, right? So okay, it is not going to affect anything for the class. So it is only necessary because a compound statement must have something in its body. A doc string could serve the same purpose, right? So you can put the something called as a point class for storing mathematical points. Instead of pass, I can write a doc string which is going to do the same thing. That is, a class definition can appear anywhere in the program, but not necessarily at the beginning. But the best practice they are following is that they are writing the class definition at the beginning of the program, but immediately after the import statement, and it always begins with a keyword called as the class. And instantiation, by creating a point class, we created a new type also called as the point. By creating the point class, we created a new type also called as the point. The numbers of members of this type are called as the instances of the type or the objects. The members of this type or members of this class are called as the instances of the class or the objects of this particular class. Creating a new instance or object or called as the instantiation and is accomplished by calling the class. That is, creation of the new instances or the creation of the new object is called as the instantiation and is accomplished by calling the class. An object is an instance of a class, or it is an instance of a class, we call it as the object. Classes like functions are callable, and we instantiate a point object by calling the point class. It is we instantiate a point object by calling the point class. It is, that is, class, point and a colon, then a pass, that is the point. If you want to know the type of the class here, so you just print the or you just type the name of the class here, the class main dot point here, okay, and blank is equal to point here. We are creating an object of this class, that is, the point is a function, the class. I am creating an object of this class, that is point, and the name of the class is blank here, and I have created that object here, that is __main_.point object tag. That is, we have created a new object. The variable blank is assigned a reference to a new point object, right? We have created an object we have assigned it to blank. It is, it may be helpful to think of a class as a factory for making objects, and so our point class is a factory for making the points. So you may think of a class as making a factory for making the objects. The class itself is an instance of a point, but it contains a machinery to make point instances. A class itself is not an instance, or it is itself is not a not an object, but it contains the machinery to make a point instances. When you print an instance, Python tells you what class it belongs to and where it should be stored in the memory. So when you print the instance, Python tells you what class it belongs to. Let us see here, point blank. When I print the blank object here, it shows the class it belongs to, right, and the memory location, right, memory location of that particular object, right, or in other words, where it has been stored in the memory. Okay, so this is about instantiation. Instantiation is nothing but creation of a new instances or the object, we call it as the instantiation. Okay, and the instantiation will be done in something like this. That is, you just create an object here, right? So by just calling the, or by just making use of the point class it is. Once it is done, if you want to know the type of the blank, sorry, if you want to know information about an object, and just type the name of the object here, it will show the class it belongs to and the stored memory location. And let us try to understand what you mean by attributes. Like real world objects, object instances have both form and the function, right? Object instances have both form and the function. The form contains data elements contained within the within the instances. We can create to an instance using the dot notations. You can assign the value to an object using a dot notation. Here is one example to state it. Blank dot x is equal to 3.0. That is, blank is an object here, and its attribute is x, and we are assigning, that is, a blank dot x equal to 3.0 and blank dot y is equal to 4.0. That is for this object, and the attributes, that is x and y, we will carry the value called as the 3.0 and 4.0 it is. This syntax is similar to the syntax for selecting a variable from a module such as math.py or string.uppercase. This syntax is very similar to the syntax for selecting a variable from a module, right? It is very similar to choosing a module from the built-in functions there. Both modules and instances create their own namespaces. Both modules as well as instances are going to create their own namespaces, and the syntax for accessing names contained in each code as the each called attributes is the same. These elements are called as the attributes. These are whatever the elements you are using at an x and y, they are called as the attributes. In this case, the attributes we are selecting is the data item from the instance. So, okay, in this particular case, right? So x and y are nothing but the data items from the given instance. That's why they are called as the attributes. And the following state diagram shows the result of these assignments, right? Following state diagram, that is a blank, we are having something called as x is initialized to 3.0 and y is initialized to 4.0. And in this case, point is the class, the name of the class. And for this new class, we have created an object called as the blank, and which is nothing but x and y. X is equal to 3.0 and y is equal to 4.0 it is. The variable blank refers to a point object which contains two attributes, right? So variable blank refers to a point object which contains two attributes called as the x and y it is. Each attribute refers to a number, right? So that is, x refers to a number, maybe it is in decimal number or the fractional number, whatever it may be, but they refers to a number. We can read the value of an attribute using the same syntax, right? So while assigning the things, what you have done in, so blank dot x equal to 3.0 and blank dot y, we have used the dot notation. So to print the value of those attributes also, we just use the same notation. That is, if you want to print the value of x of an object called as a blank, then use blank dot y, so which will print the value as 4.0. And if you want to assign, or if you want to make use of an attribute of an object and want to assign it to a variable, you can do that using x equal to blank dot x. That is, x is the x of a blank object will be assigned to x now. Okay, so when you print it, the variable called as x, so that is going to print the value as 3.0. So, okay, the formula is very simple. That is, if you want to access the value or attribute of attribute of an object, or if you want to print the attribute of an object, then you must use the dot operations, or you must use the dot operator to print the print the value of an object, or to assign the values to an value to the attributes of an object, that you can do it. The expression blank dot x means go to the object blank refers to and get the value of x it is. So okay, what is that? So it says you that go to the blank object blank refers to and get the value of x it is. In this case, we assign that value to a variable name called as the x that I already told you. So what it does is that, so it goes to blank object and get the value of x and assign it to x it is. In this case, it goes to blank object and within that blank object go to attribute code as x and get the value of that object. What is that? 3, and that will be assigned to x it is. And there is no conflict between the variable x and the attribute x. So okay, they are two different variables. So okay, there is no conflict between this x and this x. There is no confusion between the variable x and the attribute x. Okay, there is no confusion. The purpose of dot notation is to identify which variable you are referring to unambiguously. The purpose of dot notation is just to notate or to identify which variable you are referring to. Okay, so x is nothing but I'm referring to a local variable, whereas a blank dot x is nothing but you are referring to an attribute of an object here, and you can use the dot notation as a part of any expressions. So the following statements are legal. Okay, you can use the dot notation as part of any given expressions. Okay, so here are some examples which are very much legal. Python code here, the percent z and percent g and blank dot x and blank dot y, that is we are just printing the value of blank dot x and blank dot y, which is nothing but 3.0 and 4.0. similarly, we have something called as math dot square root and blank dot x to the power of 2 plus blank dot y to the power of 2 it is, which will show you something called as the distance, which is the result will be stored back into the distance. We are just printing that value, the distance of 5.0 it is. Distance 5.0, that will show you the value of the square root of these two, right? So x is how much? That is 3. 3 to the power of 2, it is 9, right? Plus 4 to the power of 2, which is nothing but 16 plus 9, 25, and the square root of that 25, it's nothing but 5, which will be stored into the distance. So now the distance will carry the value called as the 5.0, and you can pass an instance as an argument in the usual way. You can also pass the instance as an argument or a parameter to a method called in the usual way, that is define or the definition print underscore point, that is p. So okay, so use p dot x and p dot y. So p dot x, which refers to the x attribute of object p and y attribute of object p it is, and print underscore point takes a point as an argument and displays it in mathematical notations. Okay, to invoke it, you can pass blank as an argument. To invoke it, you just pass that one as an argument. Let us look at here, print underscore point blank. Blank is an object here, it's not an ordinary variable, instead it's an object. Okay, once you pass this value, it prints the value of x and y as well. It prints the value of x and y. If I replace this p with the blank dot x and blank dot y, which is nothing 3.0 and 4.0, that will be get printed on the terminal. Inside the function, p is an alias for blank. So if the function modifies p, blank changes, right? If it is nothing but in case of C and C++, we call them as the actual argument and the formal arguments. Here blank is an actual argument and p is nothing but the formal argument, right? So but in this case, when I pass the reference of blank object, that is going to be assigned to p, So p is not a normal or a variable, but it carries the references. It carries the references. That is, whatever the changes you make into reference of this one, everything will be get rectified, or it will be reflected in the blank object as well. So here is an example to demonstrate the application of the class and the object. So here we have created three methods. So chuck eggs, chuck meal, chuck milk, as well as the chuck cheese. So apart from these three methods, we have an initialization method called as the init. So what we are doing is that init, eggs, milk and cheese, these are the arguments, right? So we are assigning self.x equal to x and self.milk equal to milk and self.cheese equal to cheese it is. And similarly, I am just checking it whether the x are greater than or equal to 2 or not. If the x are greater than or equal to 2, I am printing it as a sufficient quantity, else we are print it as insufficient quantity. And for chuck milk, if it is greater than or equal to 3, we print it as sufficient quantity, else we print it as a insufficient quantity. Similarly for cheese, we make sure that cheese must be greater than or equal to 4, then we'll print it as a sufficient quantity, else it will be printed as a insufficient quantity. Okay, so what I'll do is that once I write the class definition, we'll go for creation of the objects. We'll go for creation of the object. What is that? F is equal to fridge, 2, 3, 4. 2 is nothing but the x, and 3 is the milk, and 4 is nothing but the cheese. Right? 2, x is self dot x equal to 3, 2, self dot milk equal to 3, and self dot cheese equal to 4. Now we'll make the comparison. Chuck x must be greater than or equal to 2, that is true, so it will print it as a sufficient quantity. Chuck cheese is nothing but it must be greater than or equal to 3, so that is show that, so it will print that as a sufficient quantity. Chuck milk, it must be greater than or equal to 4, but our sent value is 4, so it will print it as a sufficient quantity. So let us assume another we'll create another object here, that is f equal to fridge 2 and 3. So 2 is for milk, I'm sorry, eggs, and 2 is for milk and 3 is for cheese. So similarly here, x equal to self dot x equal to x and self dot milk equal to milk and self dot cheese equal to cheese it is. So we'll just call the functions chuck eggs, whether it is greater than or equal to 2, yes, we'll print it as sufficient quantity. And chuck cheese, which must be greater than or equal to 4, but here it is 2 here, that's why it will show you insufficient quantity. Chuck milk, which must be greater than or equal to 3, so that is true, that's why it is going to print you something called as it must be greater than or equal to 3, but here it is only 2, that's why it is going to show you insufficient quantity. So that is how your class definition and the creation of the object works. And here is one more example of the creation here, that is apple. We have the initialization function and two methods what we have it. And initialization function self.apple equal to apple and self.orange equal to orange, and apple contains check and as well as the orange contains checks. So what I'm doing is that if the contains, that is apple, is greater than or equal to 5, I'll print it as a sufficient quantity, else I will make sure that we'll print the insufficient quantity. As well as orange contains check, if the orange content is greater than or equal to 10, we'll print it as a sufficient quantity, else we'll make sure that it's an insufficient quantity. So we'll create the objects here. We'll create the object fruit equal to cart 3 and 11. 3 is for apple and 11 is for orange, right? Apple, for our apple, self dot apple, which must be greater than or equal to 5, but here it is only 3, so it will print it as a insufficient quantity. It it will show you something called as the insufficient quantity. And for the second case, that is what I'll do is that orange contains check, it must be greater than or equal to 10, but here we have 10, so it will the first one, it will show you what he called as the insufficient quantity, and the second one will show you sufficient quantity. This, so just don't look at these two statements, this is from the previous output. So the output of this program will be insufficient quantity, and second one is the sufficient quantities. And here is one more example of things here, that is string argument and the character argument here, right? I'm just checking whether a character argument is present in the string argument or not, right? I'm comparing each character in the string argument, and we're just making sure that the character argument must be present in the string or not. If it is true, if the character argument is present in the string argument, it will be printed as true, otherwise it is shown as false. Okay, and check for the present self, right? Self dot character argument in self dot string argument, return true, else you return the false value. You return true if and only if the character argument is present in the string argument, else you print it as a false argument or the false value it is. That is check equal to character. Hello is the string, and I am looking for A here. I am looking for A it is. Okay, and if check for presence, if the character is present, it will return a true value. If it is true, character is present, else it is going to print it as a character is not present. But with respect to this particular example, A is not present in hello, that's why it will print it as the character is not present. Character is not present. Okay, this is how we can work on the class and the object. In this particular case, we have one method called as a check for present, one initialization method, and one object we have created it with the two parameters hello and the A. And here is one more example of the class and the object. So we have the initialization method called as initialization, and which accepts one argument, that is a list argument, that is self dot list argument is equal to list argument. We'll calculate the sum of that argument. That is, we are just initializing ls is equal to list sum 1 2 3 4 5. We'll just print ls is equal to list sum 1 2 3 4 5. Okay, and we'll call the function, or we'll call the method called as the ls dot compute sum. We'll call the method, that is the ls dot compute sum, which will print the value as 15, which will print the value as compute sum it is, right? So whole idea is that we are passing a list as an argument, and once it is done, we are finding the sum of that, sum of the contents of the list here. 5 plus 4 9 plus 3 12 plus 2 14 plus 1, which is 15. So 15 will be get printed on the terminal. And here is one more example of the things here, right? So what is that? Sum of the elements list here. So in this case, we are not having any initialization. Directly we'll print the, directly we'll get the sum of all the elements in the given list. That is definition. Sum of all the elements, self underscore list parameters, return sum list of parameters. Ls is equal to sum of elements function, right? So sum of all the elements equal to ls dot sum of all the elements 1 2 3 4 5, so which is the list parameter here, right? So again, we'll get the same value here, that is 15, but in a different way, right? So in the last example, what we have done is that sorry. So in the last example, what he had done is that we have passed the list as an argument to the initialization function, but in this case we have not initialized anything, but we have passed the list as an argument to the function itself. We have passed the list as an argument to the function itself instead of passing it to the initialization function, but the output is same here, that is also 50. Okay, that's all for the session one. Now we'll continue in the next session. Okay.